on the 1st of February. That night, the Pantai Rakyat Singapura had a central committee meeting in Bukit Timah Road. So I was invited to that meeting, although I was not a member of the central committee. You see, their purpose was to decide on inviting me to become the chairman of the party. I went to the meeting, and I think it was by midnight they decided to appoint me the new chairman of the party, which I accepted. You see, having accepted the position of the chairmanship, and the meeting was finished, so I left the place to come back to the house, which was in Gelang. I was with another friend, Hussein Jahidin, with me. I drove the car to the house in Gelang Serai. But before I turned into the small lane that goes into the house, I saw a couple of people at the roadside, as if they were waiting for me to come back. They stood up, they immediately, you know, talking among themselves, and they dispersed. I assume they must have been special branch people. So I went to the house, and then almost 2 o'clock. Actually, that night, we were already prepared. My wife was preparing things for me because I was supposed to leave for Jakarta the next morning. And so I had about 2 hours sleep. By 3:30, 4 o'clock, I had a knock, a very big knock on the door. That was 2nd February 1963, early morning, around 4:30. And these people came, the special branch people, about six of them. They came up to the house, they ransacked the room, and they start asking all sorts of nonsense, you know, picking up this, picking up that. At the same time, they had about a jeep load of Gurkha soldiers with guns and all, you know, surrounded my house. And very stupidly, they think that I want to run away, you know. And then in that early morning like that, the villagers, you know, people around, they were all very curious, surprised that things like that happened. But none of them dared to come out. When they were ransacking the house, they were not saying anything, of course. I kept on asking, what the hell are you doing all this thing? They just kept quiet and did what they wanted to do. Picked up a few books, took my passport away, everything that I was, you know, my wife prepared for me to take to Jakarta conference. Were taken by them, and after the ransacking, they handcuffed me, and then took me to the car. It was, I think, midway between Gelang to Outram, when the special branch officer who arrested me, Inspector Hasim Ahmad, I think, he was the one who started telling me, well, Cik Said, you will be in the big newspaper tomorrow. All the newspapers will be splashing your picture. I said, why? Well, why my arrest? Why should it be a big news? No, you are not the only one. In other words, he was telling me the Operation Cold Store was on, hundreds of people have been arrested, and that I was one of them. You see, that morning, we were all taken to Outram prison. So I was taken to Outram prison, and I think for 2 or 3 days. They had a little interview there, interrogation, but there was nothing serious, just a casual kind of interrogation. And the next time, I think about the third or fourth day, then I was taken to the Central Police Station on Upper Pickering Street. I think that police station is no more there now. The whole place has been demolished. You see, this police station had, I think, three or four floors. The third floor is reserved for use of political detainees, putting them on solitary confinement. They have different types of cells there. First, maybe first category, second category, and third category. And I was confined in one of the first category cells, which was a very small room, very dark, very dirty, and you don't know, you know, you will immediately lose your sense of time because there was a small bulb up the ceiling. The light is very small, very dim, and the cell had a peephole on the door. You see, in other words, the Gurkha police who were guarding the place could look at us from outside, you know, by lifting the thing through the spy hole, they call it. And we don't know who they are. But our room is a very bare room, you know, one cement bed on the side. And then they have very dirty coconut husk mattress, very old one, very dirty and torn here and there. That was the first impression that I had. So I was thinking, how am I going to live in places like this? But perhaps I have no choice. You see, the first solitary confinement I had in Central Police Station for about 3 months. That was the first of four other solitary confinement that I had subsequently. But that was the toughest period of my detention, actually. And, you know, the type of interrogation, very intense, very oppressive. You see, most political detainees, almost all, every single one, was tortured, but not necessarily physically all. In my case, for instance, I was definitely tortured mentally, not physically. They didn't touch me, they didn't slap me as they did to many others. I don't know why they didn't do it. I was actually quite ready to wait for that kind of thing, you know, knowing their character. But anyway, to me, I think the mental torture was much more serious, much more damaging. But somehow I managed to, you know, to go through it, managed to face this kind of this day. Perhaps because I had some knowledge about it, you know, through reading of experiences of other detainees, not only in the country but all over the world. So I sort of expected the kind of treatment they would give. And in solitary confinement particularly, you will go through a very, very tough time. You have no one to talk to. You have nothing to read. No one will come and talk to you. When they put the food, they just open a little bit, put it there and close again. And you call them, try to find an excuse to talk. They just pretend that they don't hear you and just went off. I went through this for some time, you know, and it was very tough. So much so that I tried to even to talk to myself. I just shout at things. I sang songs and things like that, just to release some feeling. And it turned out to be okay. And then when interrogation started, they will take you out. As I've described in the book that I've written, the first one, the interrogation method is very obvious. In the first 2 weeks, it was very intense and very aggressive. So if you can pass through this 2 weeks, then you should be okay. For some for reason unknown to me, I never did feel that my life was threatened until at one point when I was interrogated by none other than the deputy director himself, Ahmad Khan. So when he came in, he was accompanied by about 6-7 special branch officers, all Malays. I must tell you this, that was still a fasting month, during the fasting month period. And Ahmad Khan, of course, wanted to make use of his Islamic status to try to talk to me as a fellow Muslim. Fine. When he said, you know, as a fellow Muslim, we should be honest, be frank about things. We like to help you. Perhaps you should cooperate with us. That's the only way we can help you. And I remember telling him that you cannot help me. If you want to help me, you just release me, because there's no reason. How can you help me for release? I cannot accept this arrest and detention in the first place. And I said that how can I cooperate with people who arrested me? I refuse to cooperate with people. Then he says, Ahmad Hab became very stern and very angry. You see, he could show his face, was very angry. Well, you have no choice. You have to cooperate. Well, I said, Mr. Han, I think I have a choice. I refuse to cooperate with you. Come what may. I said something like that, you know. All right, you want to be tough, huh? I said, you know that your life can be in danger also if you are taking a very tough line. You know that you can even get killed, he said. And you know that we can release you in the middle of the night. And then as you were walking in the road, we can push you from behind and I can shoot you from behind. Finish. You're finished, Said. Is that what you want? I said, no, of course not. That's not what I want. But is that what you want to do on me? I'm not surprised, I said, because things like this happen in other countries. All the colonialists and their stooges are doing things like this. You can do it. I know you can do it. But it's up to you, I said. So he was very angry. You see, after that, he refused to ask any more questions. He just threw out, stood up and went off. But I was worried. You see, for the first time, I was worried for my life. Because I thought, what if they really do it? You know, things like that. But anyway, there's nothing else I can do in the cell, back to the cell. I kept on thinking about it, you know. And true enough, I think, because the cell is checked every 15 minutes. The Gurkha fellow will come and check every 15 minutes, you know. So every 15 they come, I was wondering whether this Ahmad Khan and company came to fetch me out. So that is that, if at all, that was the only time that I felt threatened.
You were arrested under the orders of the Internal Security Council, which were then made up of representatives from the British, Singapore and the Malayan Federation governments.
Yeah.
But after 9th of August 1965, when Singapore became an independent and sovereign nation, yeah, you continued to remain in prison under the new Singapore government. Yeah. Why was that?
Yeah, that is very interesting. Because, you see, first of all, the so-called Internal Security Council, formed up by the Singapore government, the British and the Malaysian, and the Malayan government. This Security Council was supposed to decide on matters of security. But beyond that, I think each government has got their own political agenda, you know, to perform. And the British, of course, being the colonial masters, playing the bigger role there, particularly on matters of Singapore. This is where Lee Kuan Yew has always been collaborating with the British to make sure that his political power can be retained. Without the British support, Lee Kuan Yew has no chance of doing that. So this Internal Security Council with three nations actually is to help Lee Kuan Yew retain his power in Singapore, because Singapore was undergoing a political changes. A new round of constitutional talk was supposed to be held in 1963, and Singapore has to hold an election during that period, something like that. So Lee Kuan Yew was very worried about it, and he actually almost begged the British, and later on he begged the Tengku to help him retain his power in Singapore. Singapore was very lucky. Actually, Singapore independence can be said was given by the Tengku. Lee Kuan Yew did not fight for independence. Lee Kuan Yew never fought for independence. He never fought against colonial power, although he said that he's anti-colonialist, calling himself socialist and things like that. But he never really fought against the British. He collaborated with the British from the very beginning to the end until now. And at one time, he had to beg the Tengku to accept him into the merger, you know, of Malaya and then Malaysia. But Lee Kuan Yew, being Lee Kuan Yew, he always want to show that he is the great leader. He want to show his toughness. But now we all know, after reading the declassified document from the record office in London, open to the public, I've read bundles of them in the recent years, we know that Lee Kuan Yew, even the British said Lee Kuan Yew is actually a coward. And I have been saying that Lee Kuan Yew is a coward, a political coward. So you see, it was under these circumstances that when Singapore was kicked out of the Federation of Malaysia. You know, after he was making all sorts of problem for the Tunku, and Singapore got the so-called independence. Of course, that is the first time Singapore became a sovereign state. Now, when Singapore became an independent state, sponsored by Malaysia, even the entry to the United Nations was sponsored by Malaysia. Then Singapore was lucky to be an independent country, supported by Malaysia, by the British and the rest of the world. Your question of why, even after that, political detainees like us, who were in the first place arrested and detained because of merger, Singapore-Malaya and Malaysia. And yet, when Singapore was no longer in Malaysia, we were still being detained. And this is where you can, anybody who studies Lee Kuan Yew's personality, Lee Kuan Yew's mentality, Lee Kuan Yew's politics and cunningness, and this is where you will find out. He refused to release. I remember reading somewhere a statement by Lord Selkirk, who already went back to London. He said something like this: all these detainees should be released. Now that Singapore is no longer in Malaysia, then they should be released. But Lee Kuan Yew just ignored him. I remember also at one time, Lee Kuan Yew invited a few journalists from Malaysia to visit Singapore. So at one of the press conferences, one journalist asked, why is Said Zahari still being detained? And he was a Malaysian journalist. So Lee Kuan Yew said, well, I have to continue something like that. No, I have to continue to detain Said Zahari because Malaysia wanted me to do so. In other words, he was trying to put the blame on Malaysia for my continued detention after August 9, 1965. Then, of course, the Malaysian Ministry of Foreign Affairs denied that, and Lee Kuan Yew ignored the denial. And that is Lee Kuan Yew. You know, he's a person who couldn't care less what other people think. So that's how I was detained, in spite of Singapore not being in Malaysia anymore.
Did you expect to be detained for so long?
Good question. No, I did not expect. You see, I of course, I couldn't say for how long I would detain, but definitely not this long. At that time, because the political situation was changing very fast, you know, from merger to Malaysia, and then to Singapore being kicked out again, and then to Malaysia having big problem with Indonesia, and so on and so forth. So I considered my detention is related to all those things, because that is what they wanted to do. But I never expected it to be detained for this long. Particularly after Singapore was out of Malaysia, and after Indonesian-Malaysia confrontation all over, Singapore, they all become friends again, they form an ASEAN. That was in late 60s, I think 67, and yet Lee Kuan Yew wanted to do that. That I did not expect.
And while in Changi prison, you decided to learn Mandarin. Ni wei shi mao wei xiang xue hua yi ne?
Oh, wow, zhe yang shi, zhe ge wen ti shi hen hao de. 是讲的，我认为啊，在我们在监牢里面，一大多数的我们我的同志们都是受中文教育的，所以一般上他们是讲华语啊，虽然说他们也是会讲马来语，然后来我们也是参加几个 classes Malay classes， 我教他们马来文、英文，不过一般上是华文啊。 我本身呢，对这个学华文呢是很有兴趣的。从这个一段米3开始，我已经学习了中文。刚刚好那个时候有一个以前华校的老师也是被抓，他在里面，他就是做我第一次的老师在里面。不过十多年里面呢。 我的老师一个又来叫我，就是北方了，我叫另外一个叫我，到十五个老师叫我 Mandarin， 后来通过这样的办法，我很高兴的，因为能够讲华语，就能够跟他们聊，跟他们聊往，也是比较容易谈问题的，我们。 有那个政治的discussion 的时候啊，就是用华语的，所以我很希望 因为大家都能够比较容易明白我的想法了，我也可以明白他们的想法了。其实这个理由啊，我就更努力地学习这个华文。
The Singapore government had accused you of being a prominent leader of the Communist United Front. They had also claimed that you had refused to renounce the use of force to change the government. What is your response to these charges?
Yeah. Well, first of all, they accused me in the allegation of facts, so-called. One of the allegations said that I was a leading member of the Communist United Front, CUF, whatever that means, you know. To me, it was like a phantom organization, you know. Nobody knows really what is CUP, Communist United Front. Well, fair enough. I mean, they want to detain me. I mean, I was not the only one being accused of prominent member. There's so many others. Prominent member of CUP, Communist United Front, was one of the so-called allegations against me. They also have accused me of being a foreign agent, accused me of being chauvinist, accused me of being Indonesian agent, whatever, you know. There were 17 of them. You see, after we appeared on the, they have at that time, appeal committee or something, appeared just to debunk this allegation. The second time I received second incident, from 17 it came down to 10. The 17 accusation disappeared, and so on and so forth. So these so-called allegation of facts are actually nothing but an excuse for them to detain us. How else can they, you know, accuse us of being? But I challenged them even on the charges of being a foreign agent. Once I remember, I said, okay, fine. If I'm a foreign agent, it's a very serious matter. Why don't you charge me in court? Convict me, I may be even shot by firing squad. Why don't you? 2-3 times I challenged them. Then suddenly that one also dropped. So by in the end, I think there were a few. And of course, this UF accusation will remain because that's the only thing they can. And with regard to the second part of your question, refuse to renounce, what is that? Use of force to change the government. This is very interesting. This is a blatant lie. Actually, this lie is Lee Kuan Yew's lie. You know what happened? After 16 years I was in prison, I received a letter from Lord Goodman, of the masters of the Oxford University in London. I was quite surprised because I didn't know Lord Goodman, but anyway, he was good enough to write me a letter. And in that letter, he said that the Amnesty International had asked him to write to Lee Kuan Yew about my detention. To ask Lee Kuan Yew why a person like Said Zahari was still being detained after 16 years. So in reply to Lord Goodman, according to that letter, Lee Kuan Yew said the only reason the Said is still being detained was because he refused to renounce violence. And this, after 16 years, you know, this so-called refuse to renounce violence, whatever, had never been mentioned to me, had never been told to me for the last 16 years. As I told you earlier, all the 16 allegations of facts, so-called, against me to detain me, none was referred to this so-called violence or using or refused to renounce violence and so on and so forth. And I explained in my letter in reply to Lord Goodman. I said I'm sure. I mean, I didn't send the letter because I knew a letter wouldn't be sent back to him. But I explained in my book. You see, the reason why I cannot accept Lord Goodman's is because Lord Goodman doesn't seem to know, and I don't blame him not to know the condition, my condition in detention, and why I was detained, and what happened during the last 16 years. And I explained all these things, you see.
In November of 1978, the government decided to transfer you to Ubin Island.
You see, one morning suddenly they removed me from the prison, from the MCC, went to a interrogation center in Whitley Road. After the central police station was demolished, they built up a new one much more oppressive, much more secretive, more room for torture. When I was in Central Police Station, I only described my room as a dungeon of horror, but there were plenty of dungeons of horrors in Whitley Road. Now, I was suddenly taken there, but of course I was not put into those dungeons anymore, because they already changed their political line. And it was in the during that period in Whitley Road Center, I was told that I would be removed somewhere else. And true enough, after 2 or 3 weeks, I was taken to Pulau Ubin. You know, this Pulau Ubin, later on, I came to know from the officer in charge of my case. One day he was telling me, you know, Said, we surveyed this island for 3 months before we decided to put you here. And not only that, we built up a little hut for you in the middle of the island. I said, why you take so much trouble? Why you spend so much people's money on this kind of thing? Just for me to stay in the little hut? You spend so much money. He said, well, security. What kind of security? You afraid that I might run away or what? I don't know how to see me when, you know, even if I wanted to. Well, that was the irony of things, you know. Yeah, their mentality, their thinking. Now, I suppose this is more, I look at it from political reason for them to put me on the island. I think it was one way of Lee Kuan Yew to save a little face. His face has become so, you know, so dirty. He was to save a little bit more, politically speaking, you know. So instead of releasing me straight away on the main island, I think this happened a few months after Lord Goodman's letter to me, my exile to Pulau Ubin. So Lee Kuan Yew wanted to do kind of little face-saving kind of device. Put me on the island, sort of as a transition to a proper release on the mainland. And of course, I never believed that when I was there, I was really released. It was just a bigger prison without wall. And I could see my family once a week, you know, they will come freely without supervision, without restriction to this, that and the other. That went on for a year, when they finally, I think Lee Kuan Yew said, we cannot find any other excuse but to release him. When I was arrested first, it was fasting month. And when they wanted to release, it was also fasting month. And on the almost, in fact, I think 3 days before Hari Raya, fasting was to end. Then suddenly they come, they said, Said, now at last we are sending you home. So my impression was that the government, I think, had, especially the pressure on the government was so strong that the commune has no more excuse to delay and to stop from me from being released. And I believe that at that time there was a campaign by the American government of Carter administration. I think Carter administration had a special committee on human rights. And I remember a lady who headed that committee was sent down to Southeast Asia to visit these places, you know, on human rights issue. And they came to Singapore. And she wanted to meet us, but Lee Kuan Yew stopped her. Even at that point in time, Lee Kuan Yew was afraid to allow us to talk to people like that, doing human rights work. And that was from the American government. And that's what I said, Lee Kuan Yew is a coward. He was so afraid that he will be exposed.
Was the release unconditional or conditional?
Yes, unconditional in the sense I did not sign any release condition, but conditional in the sense that I have to that I cannot go into politics, I cannot join this, cannot join that. That was condition. Although I did not sign it, but I was still bound by that kind of condition, which to me means nothing because there was no politics for me to go into anyway. I think that when that condition went on for about 2 years or 3 years, and then they slowly removed them. Yeah.
Over the last four decades or so, hundreds of political and social activists have been detained under the Internal Security Act. Many of whom were released after a few months, some after a few years.
Yeah.
But you were detained for 17 long years.
Yeah.
Why were you detained for so long, and how did you manage to survive all these years?
Hundreds of detainees together, arrested together with me on 2nd of February. But after that, there were many, many more, hundreds more people were arrested and detained, and then released, detained and released. You see, some were detained for a very brief period of time, and the others much longer. I'm, although 70 years, I'm not the longest detainee in Singapore. Together with me, same period was Dr. Lim Hock Siew. Hock Siew and I were detained for 17 years, I mean, you know, that period. But that is Chia Tai Po, as you must know, was detained much longer. I think it was detained for 27 years or something like that.
32 years,
huh? Including his Sentosa period of time. Until he finally was released, he was detained for 32 years. And that is what Lee Kuan Yew is. Such a vindictive person like Lee Kuan Yew. What person like Chia Tai Po? Poor little fellow was 26 when he joined me in prison. He was a lecturer at the Nanyang University. He was very eager in his political, he has a political principle. He wants to establish a democratic and free country. Then Lee Kuan Yew accused him also of being communist, Said Zahari communist, everybody is communist. Because that is the only, you know, things that he can do to the country to detain us. But why detain for so long? It's very interesting. He, when he detained me for 17 years, until today, he cannot explain why he detained for 17 years. When I was in Hong Kong, during the launch of this book, I was interviewed by CNN. And of course about my detention, about book, and I mentioned about all these things. They were asking me, why were you detained for so long? In the same way, I gave the same answer. And I said, the only person who can answer this question is Lee Kuan Yew. So if you happen to interview me again, you go and ask him. True enough, I was told, a week after an interview with me, Lee Kuan Yew was going to China and stop over in Hong Kong, was invited by the same CNN program. And when he was asked about my decision, Lee Kuan Yew, don't ask about Said Zahari or this thing. You can ask about any other thing. And that's Lee Kuan Yew. So, you know, but I mean, everybody, if you read my book, those people who wrote forward and so on, you can see that the only reason why Lee Kuan Yew detained him because he could not face me in a political battle in Singapore politics. For a reason only known to him. Because although he knew what kind of politics I hold, principle, but he preferred to accuse me of being a communist only because he wanted to detain me for so long. Until he felt very sure, very safe, that there will be no political opposition, effective political opposition, then he decided to release us. Let Kok Siew go out, let Po Su Kai out, let me out, and the rest of the detainees.
How did you manage to cope 17 years?
Well, coping 17 years is, I must tell you very frankly, is very tough. You know, there are two things that I have to consider. My family, for instance. My family went through 16, 17 years of life without me. My children, when I was arrested, were little fellow, you know, 5, 6, 3, and so on. And my wife had to do some work, to do catering services. But fortunately, all our friends in Singapore helped her, supported her, so she managed to go through. The reason why I maintain my standard is just to counter this accusation against me. It's an accusation which was deliberately fabricated by Lee Kuan Yew, first by Lee Kuan Yew and the British, and helped by the Tengku, and then later on, Kuan Yew maintained that kind of accusation, you know. Lee Kuan Yew, being a vindictive person like that, he wants to make sure you must say sorry, you must admit defeat, you must surrender. And I told myself, Lee Kuan Yew, you will never get that from me, even when I was on the island. Lee Kuan Yew can send me. If he think I can rot in prison, he'll be very sorry that he is wrong. So I managed to maintain my stand and principle, and I'm happy that I did. I don't regret at all that I spent that much time in prison. Yeah.
Do you still hold grudges against those responsible for your detention?
I have repeated this many times, you know, when other people have been asking me about grudges. I do not hold grudges against anybody, because to me, my political detention was motivated by my political struggle and political principle. And those who did that to me, in particular, people like Lee Kuan Yew, put me into prison. Or he has also his political principle. But the only difference is that his politics is a colonial politics. My politics is an independent politics. My friend and I are struggling for the establishment of a united democratic Malaya, whereas Lee Kuan Yew wanted to maintain the colonial status of the country, although without mentioning it. So this is the difference, and therefore, my detention was political, and even he, whatever method and to use, was also for his political reason. So my grudge is not against him personally or any other person, but against the political stand of Lee Kuan Yew and company and the British and so on. Yeah.
Why is it that ex-political detainees in Singapore are reluctant to publicize their experiences?
Well, I think one reason that I can think of, and I think I am not wrong, is that the situation in Singapore, you know, the political climate in Singapore, the environment, and the policy of the government. You know, as you see, only those people who have left Singapore wrote their memoir. Francis Seow is one of them, and even Devon Nair. Devon had written his memoir. When is he going to publish it? I don't know. But for sure, Francis Seow had written 3 or 4 books. He only could do it outside Singapore. Even in my case, I started writing my memoir only when I came up here and became a fellow at the university. That was the beginning of my writing. Now, in Singapore, the situation is not conducive to doing things like this. Although Singapore will say, they will say that, why don't you do it in Singapore? You are free now. Nobody stop you from writing, yes. But they can do a lot of making things difficult for you. If you are an old man, then your children may not be able to easily get a job, even to get into the university. And then if your wife is working in the government, when you sure to be, you know, this had happened. And I don't think they can deny this, because they have been doing it and they are still doing it. And for this reason, I think many of the ex-detainees who are still in Singapore and have nowhere else to go and are very reluctant to write. This is very typical of Lee Kuan Yew's policy, you know. He will regard a person who is not with him as an enemy. And once he regards you as enemy, until you die or until he dies, you will become his political enemy. Whether you are sitting in prison or outside prison, or whether you are active or non-active. That is the sad thing about Lee Kuan Yew. He's supposed to be brilliant. 他的名字啊，李光耀也是很好的名，意思是很 brilliant 的person。不过这样的 brilliance 啊，用到这样的地方就是什么意思啊？this is a very sad thing, I think, for Singapore.
Are you still a citizen of Singapore? Do you have any intention of returning to Singapore?
Yes, I am still a citizen of Singapore. I do not intend to give up my citizenship of Singapore. I see no reason why should I? I was born in Singapore. I grew up in Singapore. I was, you know, in Singapore. I love Singapore. Singapore is my country. I used to consider and still partly consider Singapore as part of Malaya. Still a one country, a united Malaya. In my heart of heart, we are still one. You know, this political arrangement is all man-made, you know, but geographically, culturally, we are one people. I see no reason why it should be separated. And therefore, I do not intend to give up my citizenship of Singapore. But right now, I'm fortunate enough to be given the status of permanent resident here. So I do all my work here, which I cannot do in Singapore. I'm saying it in my second book. It is impossible for me to do what I'm doing now, do it in Singapore. I don't think you can interview me also in Singapore like this. But it is a fact. It's a fact of life. And if one you knows it, and you enjoy is doing it. I enjoy doing what I'm doing, you know?
You have published two books about your experiences, and you are in the midst of writing the third volume. Are you not afraid that the Singapore government, in particular Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, would take offense and act against you?
Yeah. Well, if Lee Kuan Yew wanted to act, if he could, he already had acted upon the release of my first book. In my case, there is nothing that Lee Kuan Yew can do. He can sue the book he wants, but I cannot see how he can sue me. In fact, I don't mind if he wants to sue the book or ban the book. Because whatever I said was true.
Your wife Salama passed away recently. How are you coping now, and what do you do these days?
Well, that it was a, you know, it's a great loss after 49 years together. And my wife Salama was very helpful, very supportive of my work. So without her, I had to, you know, had a long period of difficulty to cope, especially in life. And in a way, fortunately, I had some experience of being alone for so long, you know. I had a wife, but I was without my wife in a life in prison. So in a way, it is now back to that square again. You know, ever since my wife passed away, I had to cope with myself, although I have my daughter here, the children are here, but they can't be of much help to me, you know. So I decided to set up this this place for my studies, my bedroom, and my also workstation. So I work most of the time in this room, unless I have to go out to give a lecture or one at the university. From time to time, they still invite me.
Before your arrest in 1963, you were the editor of Utusan Melayu. In 1961, you initiated a press strike to protest UMNO's takeover of your newspaper.
I was a journalist actually a very short period of time, you know, 51 to 61. It so happened that I became the editor-in-chief in 1959. They tried to control the paper earlier. They couldn't do it. So when I became the editor, they thought this young fella might be different from Yusuf Isa, who was about 10 to 15 years older than me at that time. Yusuf, you know, he was the first editor-in-chief. So they might have thought that Said Zahari, being young, maybe will be more easier to sort of, you know, get him around. But to me, that was my political, my stand on journalism. You see, I work for a newspaper that works for the people, a newspaper that serves the people, not serve the party in power. And Utusan Melayu has been known until then, until the strike, as an independent newspaper, supporting or rather fighting for the interests of the underdogs, of the people in the rural areas, the workers, and the poor people. We always bring up issues from this, whether they are peasants or they are workers. Apparently, the Tunku's government at that time, having come to power, having made an agreement with the British that bound him into following British policy, especially economically and even politically, so he found it difficult to allow an independent newspaper to keep on criticizing him. In my first book, I did explain a few things that we came into conflict with the Tunku on peasants' issues, on foreign affairs, on other social issues that I, in the newspaper, we always raise up. So, when the strike was actually the culmination of that, you know, development. As far as I was concerned, when I became the editor, I continued to maintain the original policy of the paper to serve the people, the country, and the nation. I mean, the religion, Islam, and the nation. And I went on for that. I stood by that. Although they tried to, you know, induce me with all sorts of things so that I can give up that policy, in that becoming a newspaper owned by the party, which I refused to allow.
In Malaysia, you are known as the champion of press freedom. In Singapore, hardly anyone knows you, and Singapore government will still probably accuse you of having been a communist.
Yes, yeah.
What is your legacy?
I'm not surprised if Singapore maintained that. So I couldn't care less anymore, you know, because they know that they are not telling the truth. And I don't know why Lee Kuan Yew wanted to continue to do that. It's a pity, you know, it's a sad thing, honestly sad. A person in his standing, his brilliance, should stop doing it. I would love to see Lee Kuan Yew say, I made a mistake about Said Zahari. Why not? You know, no harm. Legacy, I don't know how to say it. I mean, yes, people say that I'm championing freedom. Yes, that is true. I am still championing freedom of the press. But you see, the circumstances is very much different now. A lot of laws, you know, controlling the press. And this has to be removed. I was interviewed by many people. I said, any laws that restrict the movement of this thing must be removed, particularly the ISA. Because ISA is the real culprit of all this thing, you know. All the other laws are governed by the ISA. So long as ISA is there, they create all sorts of other laws. So don't talk about freedom of the press. But in Singapore, and I mean in Malaysia at least, you can still publish. You can criticize Badawi every day, you know. They wallop at Mahathir Badawi every day, and nothing happened to that. But you do that in Singapore, oh my dear, don't try. No use, it's a waste of time. Yeah.
Today, both Malaysia and Singapore insist that the Internal Security Act is still relevant. As an ex-detainee yourself, what are your views on the ISA?
You see, they have been using ISA, supposed to be in the interest of security. But whose security? You know, all the people detained like me, like so many others, whose security was that, that our detention was? Lee Kuan Yew's security, yes. But definitely not the security of Singapore. In similar way, even here, even the Malaysian government, I've been interviewed many times. I made my position very clear. As an ex-detainee, I cannot accept this. In fact, I would be very happy if, or rather, I would demand together with this thing to demolish this ISA. The sooner it is done, the better it will be for the people, for the country, and for the government even.